Hey everybody, I'm Bryony Downs, a writer for Art Collector magazine, and I'm here today Zooming with Caroline Zielinski. And we're going to be talking about her solo exhibition Titanic coming up at Nanda Hobbs Gallery in Sydney, and it will be opening on the 18th of May. So Caroline, hi, I'm Zooming from my lounge room in Hobart, Tasmania, and where are you today?
I'm in East Sydney, in Sydney.
Obviously in your studio with all the amazing paintings behind you. Yeah. So we'll get into some questions. You've described yourself as an artist who documents their time and place in history. And obviously 2020 is a completely crazy time in history. Can you tell me about what has been helping you get through COVID-19 isolation and how you've been documenting this experience through your work?
Well, I keep thinking of the Chinese curse, which is may you live in interesting times. My dad's from former Czechoslovakia, and he escaped the war in 1968, and he was a refugee, and you know, like, he ended up in Australia, and so we grew up our whole lives with this looming threat of you know, some disaster's gonna happen, and mm-hmm. you know, we moved from the city to a leafy suburb, and you know, the first thing you did was build a bomb shelter, and you know, there was always this threat that something's coming. And after 40 years, I started to, you know, get a bit complacent, and I thought, you know, he might be a bit off kilt, but it finally came, you know. Yeah. It's finally arrived, and you know, like he said, you know, at least it's you know, you're just staying home and staying safe, you know. We're not you know, there's not, like, the army's not knocking on our door at 4 a.m, dragging us out, or, you know, bombs going. So, you know, there's been a bit of solace in that. And, yeah, it's funny, like, I think, like, if you want to know how, like, a society works, you watch it fall apart. And it's just been this really interesting, you know, observation of just how things fit together. Like, even before there was the shutdown, when there was talk of, like, you know, things happening overseas, went and bought, like, a year's worth of art supplies, and you know, I went to buy the linen that I buy at the art shop. It comes from Belgium, and I was talking to the lady there, and she said, look, we don't even know if we'll survive, you know, this shutdown, if we'll be open. Maybe you should get some more. And even if we do, like, the maybe who knows when the what will happen in Belgium, and if their factory is going to reopen. So, you know, I ended up buying this 20-meter roll of linen, which will probably last me for the next 10 years. But, yeah, it was just, yeah, it's been interesting to watch, you know, like, who's essential, who's non-essential, and that whole, how everything's interconnected. But, yeah, I think that's, yeah, interesting time.
Absolutely, and it's all about perspective, like you were saying. So how in your new show have you documented any of this experience?
I'm a very slow painter, so you know, that I think there's a lot of interesting imagery coming out of you know, what's been going on in the world, but you know, I kind of sometimes I think it's a bit it's very fitting that, you know, like, this body of work is going to be showcased in the midst of a global crisis and pandemic, because it's really, like, you know, all the works are essentially, you know, like, the individuals in there have been living their own personal pandemic for years, and some of them are riddled with disease themselves. And, yeah, and I think, yeah, and I with the Zuckerberg painting, I think it was just when I finished it, you know, was the introduction of the COVID app, you know, and which is, you know, like, all issues with privacy. So I think, yeah, it's fine. I think of, like, maybe, like, the issues that are arising now are kind of addressed for a while, like, what I attempt to address in my work, which is, you know, like, that instinct of, you know, survival over self-destruction, and, you know, purpose, and you know, how that shapes people into these, you know, bizarre characters. Yeah.
So you've actually got the Mark Zuckerberg painting behind you. Could you tell us a little bit about the story behind it? Because it's such an amazing composition with like all those photographers looming over Mark Zuckerberg and we can't see him, and the painting is actually called Faceless. Can you tell me a bit about why you decided to paint it that way?
I'll move it over a bit. I think what struck me about the image was I just thought it was like, you know, like in this single image you get this like pivotal, a representation of this pivotal moment in time where you have like the old world order, which is courts, you know, like courts, legislation, Congress, you know, the trials in Washington, and then you have this like new lawless, like new world order of, you know, Facebook and like, you know, like apparently like last year or the year before was like the first year that, you know, the collection of data on people actually became like the most valuable commodity on the stock market, more than oil. And you know, like, and you know, that curiosity about like what does that actually, you know, like the average person, like, you know, on social media, like really has no comprehension about, you know, like how that information is then deconstructed. And then, you know, like there was rumors about, you know, like that company Cambridge Analytica, which, you know, like then, you know, takes that data and, you know, like there was suspicions about that, you know, affecting like Donald Trump getting in power, you had, and even Boris Johnson. And it's, and, you know, like what was, and in the actual trial, you have, you know, these Congress people asking Zuckerberg, like, well, what do you propose we do about privacy? And it's like, anyway, but it was like this single image, you have like the these two, you know, like, to the old world and the new world, you know, meeting at this point. And and you know, like you have all the, and like all the cameras were for the first time on Zuckerberg, whereas the cameras are normally, you know, for out, you know, pointing to all of us. And you know, and it's also like when I started sketching it for the, like, it was like, like it was a bit overwhelming because it was huge, and it, but it had this like biblical sense. And it's almost like, you know, like when you have like old historical paintings of, you know, like victories of war and that, and, you know, like soldiers clamoring over each other to plant the flag of victory. And like in the center, there's, you know, like they're, instead of a flag of victory, it's like they're planting, you know, there's a camera on a stick, and, you know, the new world order is being planted. And I just thought, I think like every so often there's these like images that really point to these specific moments in time historically that, I don't know, I just feel compelled to document. But it's funny because I started this painting in January and I kept having to put it aside because I had all these looming deadlines that are like, and it was like suddenly with the shutdown, all the deadlines were eradicated. And it was like, oh, I finally have this space to just paint it. Cause it required a completely different rhythm to like the other, when I normally paint, it's quiet. It doesn't matter. It's frenetic and like, you know, but I would have burnt out with the amount of time required to paint this one. And I really like, I had the, you know, no disturbance in the space and time to just sort of, you know, methodically paint it. So, yeah, it was good for that, yeah.
Yeah, kind of a silver lining.
It continues, yeah.
Yeah. I love that connection with the history paintings. It's really fantastic. It's definitely such a moment in time. So in a lot of your work, you paint portraits. And as you said before, you paint people who have kind of quite interesting backgrounds. Can you tell me a little bit about some of the people that you have depicted in the new show, and why you chose them?
Yes, I think a lot of the portraits have been incidental. Like, it's people that I've come across or been in contact with. I've got so this one is Medusa, the seducer. Yeah. And that's my friend Emily. Yep. And I've painted her a few times. This is my third painting of her, and and I think, like, the reason I've painted her a few times is because she's available, but and doesn't, like, I have a bit of freedom with how I depict her. Like, I've had other people that I've painted that have vehemently objected to how they were portrayed, and so with her I'm a bit more liberal. But she spent like a few years in a psychiatric unit in Sweden, and she has bouts of PTSD, and hence the, like, all the shadowing in the background. So it's like, she gets pulled back into her past, and it's like this battle of a fight for present day existence. And in real life she's actually very tall, and she has enormous feet, and so she's kind of crouched in the painting, but if she stood up at any time, she would loom, three times taller than the canvas. And it's like, if she like that hope that she will step out of her trauma, anytime she chooses. And but it's that sense of, like, she can be pulled back in any time. And and I think, and then on this side, this is that's Anthea May or May Not, and this one, and that's a painting of the ballet dancer Anthea Pilko. And I normally wake up at 5 a.m. and I spend so long in this room, like, I really, like, it's, I needed to, I go there to have some kind of social contact, so I'm not, like, going insane here. And so I go and have coffee, and, like, there's a few strange characters that always end up being at this coffee shop in the morning. And she was there, like, every morning, and she would, wears this giant fur coat with very little underneath, and Adidas slides with these bright orange nail polish. And it's 5 in the morning, and all the chairs are empty, but she always chose to, like, sit in the gutter and have her coffee. And I don't know, she looked like this delicate flower growing out of, I don't know. I just I asked her if I could paint her, and and then I found out, that she was a dancer, and she'd spent the first 7 years of her life in a full body cast, correcting a hip problem, I think. I just thought, it was, like, amazing that, she was now this, her primary occupation was, so physically involved. And and I called her Anthea May or May Not, because at the time, like, she was really teetering on the brink of death. And as I painted her, I thought, she may not make it. Like, she might be dead by the time I finish the painting. And I think that's like, I think that's in, everyone and every, like, in all the paintings, this battle between, the instinct of survival and self-destruction, or good and evil running through every person. And it's and how how people's circumstances sculpt them, like people become sculptures of circumstance. And how do you depict that as not only the person, but as how do you encompass their history and everything into a single image? And the other one is a self-portrait. And I can be a bit more ruthless with the self-portraits, because I don't have to worry about offending anyone. So I offend myself enough.
So your style is incredibly distinctive. Can you tell me, so this will probably be my last question, I reckon. Can you tell me who your artistic influences are?
I attempt to navigate my way around things that have been done. I spend like 10 hours a day in here hunched over painting, and every day, and I don't want to be on my deathbed and go, I've perfectly emulated Matisse, or I have replicated the Impressionist period. So I feel like I never had a voice, and everything sort of was tangled up, and making art has been like a voice. So I try to try to navigate my way around artists, so I don't, if it's been done, it's been done. And but I do have artists that I profoundly admire. Like if I had to be locked in a cave a few great art works of art, I'd have a Hieronymus Bosch painting there, and Van Gogh, probably a Toulouse-Lautrec, and maybe a Mark Rothko for good measure, one of his cathedral paintings.
That's great. That's really insightful. That was an excellent chat. Thank you so much, Carolyn.
The Titanic.
Title. You were originally going to call it Us and Them, or the Titanic. So what made you decide on Titanic in the end?
I was going to call it Us and Them because I think there's always a, everyone needs an enemy. There's always an enemy, whether it's a nation or the battle is within ourselves, and it's who's the us and who's the them. But then I started, so the show was meant to be in October, and and then it got moved to May, and I thought, the world might not actually be here in October. We don't actually know where this is going to end. It's, we're 2 months into a pandemic. It could get worse. The political upheaval could lead to World War III. And, the world might not even exist in October. And then it kind of felt it kind of feels like I'm shuffling deck chairs on the Titanic. And, I might as well... play the violin while I go down.
That's a great explanation for that title. So thank you for joining us today, Caroline. It was excellent.
Thank you.
To you. Thank you, everybody, for listening. You'll be able to see Caroline's new work at Nanda Hobbs via appointment or online at nandahobbs.com. And again, thanks for joining us, and we will see you next time.
Thanks, Brian. Thank you.